So students, today we are starting the chapter Fundamental Unit of Life. Fundamental Unit of Life, that is cell. Now what is cell? Now think of a building which is being constructed near by your house or anywhere you see. So what do you see? That the main ingredients which are needed for the construction of building are bricks, cement, sand, etc. and many more things. But what is that functional unit through which a building is made? And that is bricks. Okay. A single brick when combined together forms a building, a huge building. So this single brick can be considered as a cell for that building. Similarly, our body is also made up of various types of cells, and all these cells are helpful for performing the various functions. So cell is the structural and functional unit of life. So cell can be considered as the structural as well as the functional unit of life. Now why cell can be considered as a structural and functional unit of life? Because it is considered as structural because our body is made up of cell. So it is the structural unit and functional unit because each cell through which our body is made perform a different functions. So cell is considered as the structural as well as the functional unit of life. Now cell was discovered by Robert Hooke. Cell was discovered by Robert Hooke. He experimented on the corpses. Now what are corpses? When the tree grows to a very high length or becomes very old, then the stem and the roots become rigid and not and dead structure. So when it was cut, then and when it was seen under the microscope, various small cells were seen, and from there the idea came that our body is also made up of these small cells, and so the cell was discovered by Robert Hooke. Now it is also the cell theory. Cell theory means all cells arise from pre-existing cells. Pre-existing cells means the cells which were present before arise from that. So it is known as cell theory. So cell theory means the cells arise from pre-existing cell. So it is known as cell theory. It was given by Shielding and Chacon. Now if we are talking about cell, so how a single cell is able to perform such a huge functions which keeps our body alive, which makes our body function properly. So how? So if we talk about cell consists of various organelles. Cell consists of various organelles which are present, and each organelle is present for performing various functions. Now if we take the structure of cell, there are various organs, there are various many components present that help in the functioning of the cell. Now see the structure of cell. I'm drawing a cell. This is the structure of cell. Now it consists of nucleus, it consists of mitochondria, it consists of Golgi apparatus, it consists of endoplasmic reticulum. So these are the organelles which we will study. So mitochondria, nucleus, endoplasmic reticulum, lysosomes, ribosomes. So there are cytoplasm, there are many organelles present in the body which has a particular function to perform and which helps our body to make life. So there are mainly four components in the cell, that is plasma membrane, second is nucleus, cell wall and cytoplasm. So these are considered as the main components of the cell. These are considered as the main components of the cell. Main components of. Besides these, there are organelles like endoplasmic reticulum. Then lysosomes, then Golgi apparatus, plastids, vacuoles, etc. So these are the organelles present in the cell. So one by one we will see it clearly. Plasma membrane. Now, if we see the structure of the cell, so the outer part of any cell, whether it is a plant cell, whether it is an animal cell, the outer part is known as the plasma membrane. The outer part is known as the plasma membrane. Now, plasma membrane is made up of lipids, bilayer, lipids and protein. Okay. Now, if we see the structure of plasma membrane is somewhat like this structure. So this is bilayer, phosphate bilayer structure of the plasma membrane. Now if we take this single seed, it looks like somewhat like this. This can be considered as the head, this can be considered as the tail. It is hydrophilic, means water loving. It absorbs water and glucose etc. and it is fatty. It is made up of fatty acids and all, means fatty acids etc. can be absorbed here. Now, if we see the structure as a whole, plasma membrane structure as a whole, now how it is working? So what is happening? This is the structure of plasma membrane. It is made up of lipid bilayer. Now, this is the protein. This is protein. It is intrinsic protein. Intrinsic protein. Now, intrinsic protein means the protein which are embedded between the bilayers, between the lipid bilayer. Now, what is the role of this protein? What happens? Now, water and glucose, when it comes from the outside, this is the cytoplasm of the cell, this is the outer membrane, so this is the plasma membrane and inner will be the cytoplasm. Now, in order to take the water inside the cell, what happens? It can absorb, the hydrophilic portion of the bilayer can absorb the water, but it cannot, the tail portion cannot absorb the water, it only absorbs the fatty acids, so it does not allow the water to pass here. So for the transport of water and glucose, it needs a channel to enter inside the cell. So how it needs, it comes through this pathway, and this pathway is known as the passive transport. This pathway is known as the passive transport. So what happens? Oxygen and glucose is entering inside the cell through this protein. This is the intrinsic protein, and the process and the pathway through which it is coming is known as the passive transport. Why passive transport? Because it does not require any use of ATP molecule. Means it does not require any energy to send the water molecules inside the cell. So this was all about the structure of plasma membrane. Now, movement in plasma membrane occurs mainly through two processes. That is diffusion and osmosis. Now, what is diffusion? Diffusion is the movement of molecules from a region of high concentration to low concentration. So diffusion means the movement of molecules from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration. And diffusion mainly involves the movement of gases in and out of the cell. Gases in and out of the cell. So diffusion involves gases transport in and out of the cell. So suppose this is a cell. It contains the nucleus. This is cytoplasm. Now suppose the concentration of O2 is very less here, and the concentration of O2 outside the cell is very high. Means high concentration of oxygen is present here, and here low concentration of oxygen is present here. So what will happen? Oxygen will try to go inside the cell. So what is happening? The higher concentration region of the oxygen is moving towards the lower concentration region. So this is diffusion. It occurs in gases. Now osmosis. Osmosis is also the movement of molecules from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration. But it occurs in liquids. Suppose we take the example of water. Now what is happening? If the cell is there, nucleus, cytoplasm. Now suppose the concentration of water is high here. Concentration of water is high here and concentration of water is low here. What will happen? The water will come out of the cell. So this is osmosis. Similarly, if the concentration would be high here and concentration would be low here, then water would have gone from higher concentration to the lower concentration. So this is osmosis. Now there are three conditions which helps a movement of solution. Now what are the three conditions? Now hypertonic solution. Then isotonic solution. Then hypotonic solution. These are the conditions which happens when there are some changes inside the cell. Now in hypertonic solution, what happens? If the cell is having high concentration of water and outside it is low concentration of water, then the water will start coming out, because it is osmosis means the movement of water molecules from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration. Here it is having less amount of water, here it is having high amount of water. So what is happening? Water is coming out of this cell and it leads to shrinking of the cell. Shell will shrink. So this is hypertonic solution. Hypertonic solution means the shrinking of the cell due to the movement of water molecules from inside the cell containing high concentration of water to outside the cell containing low concentration of water. So this is hypertonic solution. Now isotonic solution. Isotonic solution means when, iso means equal. there is equal amount of water present outside the cell and equal amount of water present inside the cell. So it is isotonic solution. Suppose this is the cell. Now what is happening? Water is present in equal amount. Water is present in equal amount. So there will be no changes in the shape. It will remain as it is. Because it is managing how much water is being lost, that much water is being entered inside the cell. So it maintains the balance. So the shape remains the same. Now third is hypotonic solution. Hypotonic solution means if the cell is having low concentration of water and high concentration of water. Low concentration of water inside the cell and high concentration of water outside the cell. If it is having, then what is happening? It will make the cell bigger. Okay, and it might happen that if more and more amount of water is entering inside the cell may burst. So, that much water should only enter inside the cell, which may keep the cell in a proper shape. So, these are the three movement of the water molecules which may affect the shape of the